हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू माय चैनल क्लिनिकल बायो केमिस्ट्री बाय डॉक्टर पी के प्रभाकर। टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट अनदर हार्मोन दैट इज फॉलिकल स्टिमुलेटिंग हार्मोन एंड ल्यूटिनाइजिंग हार्मोन। कॉमनली वी आर गोइंग टू कॉल देम गोनाडोट्रोपिन्स। सो दिस गोनाडोट्रोपिन्स, सो फर्स्ट वी विल सी सम ऑफ द बेसिक फीचर्स ऑफ दिस गोनाडोट्रोपिन्स एंड लेटर ऑन वी विल टॉक अबाउट देयर मैकेनिज्म ऑफ एक्शन एंड देयर एक्शंस। सो दीज गोनाडोट्रोपिन्स आर सिंथेसाइज्ड एंड रिलीज्ड बाय द गोनाडोट्रोपिक सेल्स ऑफ द एंटेरियर पिट्यूटरी। दिस गोनाडोट्रोप मीन्स दिस हार्मोन गोनाडोट्रोपिन्स आइदर इट विल बी FSH और LH, बोथ एक्ट्स ऑन द गोनाड्स। गोनाड्स मीन्स इट विल बी मेल गोनाड्स एंड द फीमेल गोनाड्स। इन केस ऑफ मेल इट विल बी टेस्टिस एंड इन केस ऑफ फीमेल इट विल बी ओवरी। सो द टारगेट ऑर्गन फॉर दिस गोनाडोट्रोपिन्स आर टेस्टिस एंड द ओवरी। Where when these gonadotropins works on testis and ovary, they increases the production of sex hormones, especially estrogen and progesterone. The stimulations, once this hormone works on testis and ovary and increases the production of sex hormone, and these hormones ultimately works for the spermatogenesis and oogenesis. So there will production of sperm and ovum will be increased. These follicle so two important gonadotropins we are having, that is follicle stimulating hormone FSH and luteinizing hormone that is LH. Other than these two, there are number of other gonadotropins also we are having, like one of the important gonadotropin that is the placental HCG, human chorionic gonadotropin. That is the only only gonadotropins which is produced during the pregnancy. These gonadotropins are produced by specific cells that is called as gonadotropic cells. These gonadotropic cells have multiple different names. Sometimes they are called as gonadotrophs, sometimes they are called as gonadotrophs, delta cells or delta basophils. Why it is basophils? Because it is going to be stained with the basic dye only. It can retain basic dye. That's why it is called as basophils. These gonadotropic cells are the endocrine cells of the anterior pituitary, which releases, which gives us FSH and LH. This FSH and LH is under the regulation of a hypothalamic hormone that is called as gonadotropin releasing hormone. So gonadotropin releasing hormone GnRH is going to be released from hypothalamus, which works on pituitary gonadotropes and insist pituitary gonadotropes to release FSH and LH. One important feature of these gonadotropic cells are they are having insulin receptor, means they can be overstimulated by high amount of insulin. So whenever our body will have increased insulin level, the activity of these gonadotrophs will be increased, means in that circumstances we will have high amount of FSH and LH in our body. This may leads to infertility as hormone release during release levels are disrupted. These gonadotropes are also regulated through the feedback inhibition mechanism by estradiol or estrogen. So estrogen, which is going to be produced by ovary, they are going to under-regulate this, feedback regulate or negatively regulate or under-regulate, you can call it, release of FSH and LH. These gonadotropins, either FSH and LH, are also used for the fertility treatments, like the use of FSH, if we are going to use in case of female, so they will be used in case of female to produce mature follicles, egg cells, or insist induce ovulation process. When it will be used in case of male, it will be to increase the sperm count or the increase the viable sperm counts. So that is the function they are going to be used during IVF or in vitro fertilizations. This is the how it is going to be released. So we are having anterior pituitary glands. In the anterior pituitary glands, we are having gonadotropes. That gonadotropes or gonadotropic cells is going to regulate LH and FSH. So the message comes to this anterior pituitary cells from hypothalamus mediated by GnRH. GnRH works on these cells and then insists them for the release of FSH and LH. Other than these two hormones, anterior pituitary is going to release number of hormones. Like pituitary have two important regions, anterior and posterior. Anterior is called as adenohypophysis and posterior is called as neurohypophysis. Anterior hypophysis produces more than 6 different hormones, like growth hormone, prolactin, thyrotropins, TSH, adeno-ACTH, FSH, LH, lipotropins. So these all are roughly, everything is are having tropin hormone, tropins. So here we are going to see FSH and LH, which main target is gonads. Gonads means testis and ovary. Then this gonadotropins, if you'll see, this is the pictorial things. So we are having hypothalamus. So during whenever body gets a sensation, that time hypothalamus going to release GnRH, and this GnRH works on anterior pituitary gonadotropes. Gonadotropes release FSH and LH. This FSH and LH works on gonads, that is testis and ovary in case of male and female, which testis releases testosterone and ovary releases estrogen. Especially the function of testosterone to induce a sperm count, a spermatogenesis process, and the function of estrogen is mainly ovulation and give fertilized, means mature egg, for which is ready for the fertilization process. So ultimately a sperm and egg will be formed. So this is how it works. So we are having GnRH, which is coming from hypothalamus. That comes through this hypophysis infundibulum to the anterior pituitary. There it increases, works on anterior pituitary gonadotropes, and FSH and LH will be released. This FSH LH works on the testis and ovary. Testis releases testosterone and ovary releases estrogen. So testosterone has two important functions. One, on the primary sexual organs, there it normally induces spermatogenesis, more sperm formation will be there, sperm synthesis will be there. And in the secondary sexual character, where penis and scrotum will grow, facial hair will come, larynx will enlarge, and voice pitch will be lower, shoulders will be broadened, body, armpit, pubic hair will grow, musculature increases, body widens. Similarly, estrogens also works on two, both primary and secondary sexual organs. In primary sexual organ, folliculogenesis will be there, where follicle cells will give you matured follicles, for which is ready for fertilizations. And it also works on secondary sexual character. There breast development and maturation of breast, hip form will be broadened, and pubic hair will grow. So this is the overall function. Some of the biochemical features of FSH and LH, if you'll see, both FSH and LH are gonadotropins, because they are releasing from the anterior pituitary. They are chemically glycoproteins and a polypeptide hormone. Glycoprotein polypeptide hormone means it is a protein, but not pure protein. It is a glycoprotein, modified protein, where carbohydrates, either it will be monosaccharides, disaccharides, and polysaccharides will be associated with the proteins. So protein will be modified. Not only FSH and LH, we are having HCG, we are having TSH, all four are in the belonging to the same category. Later on we will see it. These both hormones are secreted by gonadotropic cells, that is gonadotropes. This going to regulate the development, growth, pubertal maturations, and reproductive process of the body. Means from the menstrual cycles up to the fertilizations in case of female, and in case of male, spermatogenesis and the sperm transfer. Both FSH and LH works together synergistically, means both complement each other's activity, each other's function. Now if you'll see FSH characteristic features, it is 35.5 kilodalton glycoprotein, which is heterodimer, means it is having two different units, two different polypeptide chains, alpha chain and beta chains, and both are different. That's why it is called a heterodimer. Two chains, one alpha chain is consisting of 92 amino acids, and beta chain is consisting of 111 amino acids. FSH, not only FSH, FSH, LH, HCG, and TSH, all four hormones have similar alpha chains. These four hormones have same alpha chain of 92 amino acids, only they differ in their beta chain. Means their functions, because FSH will have different function, LH will have different function, HCG will have different function, TSH will have different function. So the physiologically they are different, by function they are different, that is only because of the beta chain of these proteins, hormones. The alpha subunit of glycoprotein LH, FSH, TSH, and HCG are identical and consist of 92 amino acids, while their beta chains are varying. Both subunits are required, alpha and beta, both are necessary for their activity. And the sugar, because I have told you it is a glycoprotein, so the sugar, which is covalently associated with asparagine amino acid, and which type of sugar is associated there? It is N-acetyl galactosamine, mannose, N-acetyl glucosamine, galactose, and sialic acid. So all the four types, it will be monosaccharide also, disaccharide also, polysaccharide also. In human, the gene for alpha subunit is present on the chromosome number 6, and the gene for beta subunit is present on chromosome number 11. Now, this FSH release is under the regulation of GnRH, but it is also regulated by inhibin. So inhibin is, as its name suggests, it is going to inhibit the FSH secretions, and activated by activin, which is activate enhancing the secretion of FSH. And these are secreted from the ovary and testes. The main function of FSH in our body is it stimulates the growth and maturation of ovarian follicles. Ovarian follicles is the follicle which you normally grow in our body, means female body. That is, from germinal epithelium, primordial follicle, then primary follicle, then vesical follicle, then lastly Graafian follicle. So all these follicles, all these developmental stages of egg is called as Graafian ovarian follicles. So this growth and maturation will be insisted by FSH. It also stimulates the estrogen secretion from the ovary, promotes the endometrial changes for in characteristic of the proliferative phase, and stimulate spermatogenesis in the male. Similarly, if you will see the leukotropins, leutropins or leutrophins or LH, this is also consisting of two polypeptide chains. Alpha chain will be same as in case of FSH. Beta chain is, there we had only 111 amino acid, here we are having 120 amino acid, and both subunits are required for their activity. Structurally, they are similar to FSH, TSH, HCG, and LH. Here, again, I have told you alpha subunit for all the four amino hormones are same, only they are differing in beta. In the female, the acute rise occurs in case of LH, and that is roughly just before the ovulation process. Normally, ovulation occurs at the mid phase of the menstrual cycles, at the 14th day. So just before the 14th day, between around 12 days, LH, there is an acute rise in LH, and that is called as LH surge. This LH surge normally triggers the ovulation process, and the Graafian follicles will be developed into the corpus luteum. This corpus luteum is almost matured egg, which is ready for fertilization. Either it will be fertilized or it will be non-fertilized. In case of male, this LH, also called as interstitial cell stimulating hormone, ICSH, which normally stimulates the Leydig cell for the production of testosterone. We are having four important cells: Leydig cells, Sertoli cells in case of male, and Theca cells and granulosa cell in case of female. This FSH and LH both work synergistically for their activity. The biological life span, half-life of LH is 20 minutes, which is shorter than FSH, which is having 3 to 4 hour half-life, and HCG, that is having 24 hours. So you can see this is in minutes, not in hours. FSH 3 to 4 hours, this is in minutes, and HCG roughly 24 hours. The genes for the beta subunit for LH, alpha subunit gene will be on the chromosome number 6 like FSH, and the beta chain of gene for the FSH was on chromosome number 11, here it is on chromosome number 19. So you need to remember this one. The main function of this the main function of LH is it promotes the secretion of estrogen from the follicle, release of ovum from the ovarian follicle, that is going to be converted into corpus luteum. So, and this corpus luteum produces progesterone and estradiol estrogen, produce the testosterone from the Leydig cell of testes. So these are the four important functions of LH. How it works? Because you know that this FSH, LH, HCG and TSH, these are peptide hormone, protein hormone. So obviously they cannot cross the plasma membrane, they cannot enter into the plasma membrane. So their receptor will be on the plasma membrane. So they bind on the plasma membrane, and this receptor for FSH, LH, and GH, TSH, and HCG are GPCR, G protein coupled receptor, which also called as 7 transmembrane helix. This 7 transmembrane helix, once a hormone binds there, they are going to activate G protein, and ultimately G protein walks through cyclic secondary messenger, that is either cyclic AMP or calcium double plus ion, which ultimately induces different kind of biological responses. Means the activity of FSH, LH, TSH and HCG is through GPCR, G protein coupled receptor. Now, how these hormones FSH and LH works in case of male and female for the testosterone production and the estrogen production. This is the cross-sections of the seminiferous tubules in case of testes. There you can see these cells, which is outside, that is called as outside the basal lamina, that is called as Leydig cells. And here we are having spermatozoans, spermatogonium, and this big cells, that is called as Sertoli cells. Now, LH first, once it will be released from pituitary through blood circulation, it will come to the testis, and in the testis we are having Leydig cells. Here, there LH binds, and LH stimulates the release of testosterone production. This testosterone, because it cannot be converted to estrogen in case of Leydig cells, because conversion of testosterone to estrogen or estradiol requires aromatase enzyme. This aromatase enzyme is absent here. So testosterone has to come out from the Leydig cells and enter into the Sertoli cells because of aromatase enzyme. Meanwhile, this on the Sertoli cells we are having FSH receptor. So FSH binds, stimulate the activation of aromatase enzymes, which converts this testosterone into estradiol. And this estradiol estrogen, once it will be released, it will be regulating the protein synthesis in the nucleus of the Leydig cells, as you can see here. So it starts from here, it will be converted, and then it's regulate here. So this is how it works. So same thing here, it will be hypothalamus, GnRH, then FSH and LH, which works on Sertoli cells and Leydig cells, testosterone. This testosterone works on the spermatogenesis process. Sertoli cells also produces inhibin and activin, which normally regulates either negative regulations or the positive regulations. In case of female, this is the follicular cells, where you can see these outer cells are called as theca cells. And these spherical cells here, or this one, are called as granulosa cells. So here also similar type of situation will be there. First, on the theca cells, LH binds on the theca cells. Theca cells convert cholesterol into testosterone and androstenedione. Now, on this LH, theca cells, we are having LDH receptor, because through that LDL only, it gets cholesterol. So cholesterol come to this theca cell through LDL receptors. So cholesterol will be converted to testosterone and androstenedione. Because these two will not be converted in the theca cells into the estradiols, because they don't have aromatase enzyme. So both testosterone and androstenedione has to come into the granulosa cells, where FSH is going to activate this aromatase enzyme. And as soon as this aromatase enzyme will be activated, it will convert testosterone and androstenedione into So it will be converting into estrogen, and this estrogens again regulates aromatase enzymes, or it works on for the production of other hormones. This is same thing. So we are having on the thecal cells or theca cells, we are having LH receptor, which normally activates the enzymes for the conversion of cholesterol into androstenedione. And then it comes to the granulosa cells, where FSH normally activates through this aromatase enzyme through protein kinase A, and androstenedione will be converted to estradiol. this estradiol will be released from here and it will go to the blood circulation and walks different organs, different places. Now, in case of women, of the childbearing age, means in the matured women, FSH normally stimulates the growth of matured egg. Before that one, just a few information about the menstrual cycles. As in case of human body, menstrual cycle is a very complex process. It regulates regulatory system, because it is a very complex process, so its regulatory system also involves, it is a complex system. So it requires hypothalamus, anterior pituitary, ovary, and growing graafian follicle. So hormones from all the places is needed there. The hormones, it will be regulated through hypothalamus, pituitary and ovary axis, means all three organs are going to involve there. So there are means hormones comes from these three places and that regulates the menstrual cycle. Hypothalamic hormone, that is GnRH, which regulates. Pituitary hormone, that is gonadotropins, FSH and LH. And ovarian hormone, that is estrogen and progesterone, that regulates it. So if you see the GnRH, normally it triggers the cyclic changes of the menstrual cycles by stimulating release of FSH and LH. And this depends on external factor as well as the feedback regulations. Then second hormone, that is we are going to talk about FSH and LH, which normally modulates the ovarian and uterine changes. This FSH and LH either works directly or indirectly via the ovarian hormones, that is estrogen and progesterone. FSH especially, it stimulate and recruit the growth of immature ovarian follicles through sequential events like germinal epithelium, primordial follicles, primary follicles, vesical follicles and lastly graafian follicles. At the same time, luteinizing hormone triggers the ovulation process and sustain the corpus luteum. Then lastly comes the ovarian hormones, which is released by the follicle and the corpus luteum. So here ovarian follicles releases estrogen and corpus luteum releases progesterone. Normally all other hormones, so four, we are having four hormones, progesterone, estrogens, FSH and LH, which normally regulates the menstrual cycle in case of human. That we will see further in the graphs also. So other hormones normally reaching only once at the peak during the whole 28 days menstrual cycle, but estrogen reaches peak two times during the menstrual cycle. First during the follicular phase, just before the ovulation, and second one is during the luteal phase. Progesterone is almost absent in the follicular phase, that we will see in the graphs. So the menstrual cycle is normally divided into two phases, follicular phase and the luteal phase, each will be roughly of 14 days. During the follicular phase, first phase, FSH initiates the production of estrogen by the follicles, estradiols, and the two hormones work together for the development of egg follicles, means their growth from germinal epithelium to the graafian follicles. At the end of the follicular phase, means roughly around the 14 days, there is a surge of FSH and luteinizing hormone. So it will be very high. This release of the egg from the ovary, that is called as ovulation, occurs shortly after the surge of this hormone. The hormone inhibin as well as estradiols and progesterone helps to control the amount of FSH released by the pituitary. FSH also facilitates the ability of the ovary to respond to LH. As a woman ages and the menopause approaches, ovarian follicles wanes and eventually ceases. At this, FSH and LH level will vary high. So this is ovulation phase, roughly 14 days. So first phase we are having follicular phase and second we are having luteal phase. Some books will have four phases, follicular phase, ovulation, luteal phase and menstrual cycle. If you'll see the hormones level, so FSH normally it will be high and at the around the 14th day, midday, it will be, there will be very surge of this one and the luteinizing hormone. So this is called as LH surge, luteinizing hormone surge. FSH increases the estrogen formation, so estrogen increases from the growing follicles, and progesterone, their growth will be in the luteal phase. Estrogen, we have one peak at this place in just before the ovulation and second peak in the luteal phase. Similarly, you can see here also, estrogen have one peak here and one peak here, progesterone only in the luteal phase, and this is LH surge and FSH search. How we are going to measure this LH? So there are a spot urine test normally which detects the luteinizing hormone surge is used to evaluate and treating infertility. This indicates the period when woman is the most fertile because luteinizing hormone release just before the ovulation process. So after this LH surge only ovulation will occur. So once we will see the peak very high amount of LH production, it we can assume that ovulation is going to happen. So LH surge precedes 24 hours of ovulation can be recognized easily. Urine 24 hour sample is a better choice to avoid this variable amount of secretion of LH. LH assay can give a better idea for ovulations. This will be there will be a surge of LH level. The best sample is from 11 am to 3 pm. LH surge gives the peak fertility period which is due to ovulation process. This will be roughly between 12 to 16 days of the cycle depending varying woman to woman. And this surge can be found by taking a daily sample near the mid cycle. This is called as luteinizing LH surge, and after this surge only at this place normally only we are going to have ovulation process. So LH surge is an indicator of ovulation, so that is the most fertile period in case of women. FSH is typically measured in the early follicular phase of the menstrual cycle, typically day 3 to 5 counted from the last menstrual cycle. At this time the level of estradiol and progesterone are at the lowest point because from there it will slowly estrogen will start increasing. FSH level at this time is often called as basal FSH level to distinguish from the increased level of approaching during the ovulation. So if you'll see, so I'm talking about this level of FSH at this point, this is called as basal level of FSH. So basal level of FSH is different from this LH FSH surge. FSH is normally measured in the international unit, and this is the definition of FSH. If you'll see the table, this is the normal amount of FSH in different age period, different ages, different phases of the menstrual cycles. Similarly, this is the normal level of luteinizing hormone in different phases and in case of male and female. And this is in which phase, which type of hormone is going to increase. Like if you'll see the follicular phase, which is the first phase, their LH will be very low. FSH will slowly increasing and it will be high. Progesterone and estrogen will be also low. In the late follicular phase, means during the mid cycle, just before the ovulation process, FSH will be low only, but LH surge will be there. And progesterone will be low, but estrogen level will go or also will be high. So LH and estrogen will be very high in the just before the ovulation process. Then during this is the ovulation process, then this is the luteal phase and a start of the next cycle. There are also we are having imbalance in the FSH level. So FSH level imbalance in a woman, it can be by many reasons like loss of ovarian function, that is ovarian failure. Then PCOS, polycystic ovarian syndromes, menopause, pituitary adenoma, precocious puberty or ovarian dysgenesis, that is Turner syndrome. Precocious puberty is when puberty comes just before the natural time. Like if girls get puberty before the age of 8 and boys getting puberty before the age of 9, that is called as precocious puberty. Similarly, this high level of FSH can be found in male also, that will be in the condition of testicular dysgenesis, that is Klinefelter syndrome. Testicles are absent or not functioning properly. Testicles have been damaged by a disease such as alcohol dependence or because of the any other X-ray or chemotherapy. High value in the children may mean that the puberty is not about to start. Similarly, there will be imbalance in case of FSH level, decreased level of FSH seen in case of pituitary failure, hypothalamic failure, stress, anorexia nervosa, malnutrition. Anorexia nervosa is a fear of gaining body weight, so not getting proper food. So because of not getting proper food to avoid body weight gain. Low value of FSH can be found in case of women not producing egg. Prevention ovulation leads to infertility. A man is not producing a sperm. So whenever low level of FSH will be there, these things can occur. A hypothalamus or pituitary gland is not functioning properly, tumor is present, starvation or stress will be there. Similarly, in case of LH, the increased value of LH seen in case of gonadal failure, that is menopause, Turner syndrome or Klinefelter syndrome, precocious puberty or pituitary adenoma. Rage level of both FSH and LH can increase in the condition of gonadal failures, polycystic ovarian syndromes or during menopause. And during menopause, after the menopause, normally FSH LH level will be high, so estrogen level comes down, and estrogen is a hormone which normally regulates our calcium level. So in case of menopausic women, because estrogen is not there, so calcium will, bone will be demineralized, bones will be porous and it will be more fragile, so it will be broken. So more fractures can occur in case of menopausic women. The decreased level of LH can be seen in case of pituitary failure, where both FSH and LH will be low. Hypothalamic failure will also lead to the low LH and FSH level in case of stress, anorexia nervosa, malnutrition or secondary gonadal failures. The FSH and LH level will be low. So this is roughly all about the FSH, LH, their function, their mechanism of action. We have seen in the graph that progesterone level is almost absent in the follicular phase, but it plays a very critical role in case of luteal phase. Estrogen is responsible for the growth of follicles, both induces changes in the uterus, cervix and vagina and may prepare women for fertilized eggs, implantation and their growth. These are under the regulation of GnRH through FSH and LH. So hope you have understood it. Thank you very much. If you have not subscribed my channel till now, you can subscribe it now. You can press the bell button so that whenever I will upload the video, you will get all the video on the time. Thank you very much. You can follow me on the different social networking sites also. If you have any query, any comments, you can write in the comment box. Thank you very much.